Welcome to the video. We continue our accelerated pace here, and with very good reason. I was resting this morning in bed, I suddenly experienced as if a truck had run into the whole back, my whole back side of my body, like a sudden impact. Wham! And I said, "What in the world had just happened? Am I okay?" And I was still lying there. And my, you know, this was hours ago, and I'm still shaking from it. I have to call it sudden impact. I would have to say sudden impact. Is this related to something that's going to happen in the world? I suspect it is. Blindsided, you know, it's like being blindsided from behind. That was my experience. My whole body felt like just been completely slammed into. But I feel okay. I feel okay. So I've never had an experience like that. I cannot explain what took place, but I feel that it's very, very significant. Are we about to be, you know, blindsided in some way? Well, just as importantly, and even maybe more so actually, for sure more so, is that the Holy Spirit suggested a practice to me again this morning, and it's a spiritual practice that we can practice. It's very simple, and it's called a neither nor practice, the neither nor practice, where we just say, we just continuously say my mental content, my thinking content is just neither nor. Neither nor. All my thoughts are neither nor. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. These are my thoughts. Neither nor. So allow your thoughts to be in the form of neither nor. Instead of getting rid of all thoughts, as we said, because of our continuity problem, we won't do that. Instead, we put them in the form of simply neither nor. So I began practicing that, practicing it, and it was very, 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 very profound. And this ties in with the practice that we have been doing. I am not this. I am both this and not this. But it's sort of a shorthand way. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. It's really easy to say. Everything, it's all neither nor. All thoughts of mine are neither nor. All thoughts of mine are neither nor. So we talked the last video about seeing all our thoughts in like a cloud that's off in the distance, and let those thoughts move. But this is an advancement even over that. It's to have the cloud there with the thoughts moving, but all thoughts are now in the form of neither nor. Neither nor, neither nor, neither this nor that, 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 neither this nor that. So you know the content, the form of the thoughts are in neither nor. So you still have the cloud of thoughts. They're still at a distance. You're in this perfect clearing. And you know your all thoughts are in the form of neither nor. How about that? Huge advancement thanks to the Holy Spirit. Neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. So we will see what we can get out of this video. It is Labor Day morning. We're headed into a time of extremis where we realize that we have to come up with, we have to have answers. We have to have breakthroughs. We have to have peace of mind. We have to have stability. That's very, very important. Cannot fail at this. So this is the attitude that we have here, which is one of effort. We see the finish line. We need to get across that finish line. So neither nor, neither nor. The willingness to put all content of our thinking into neither nor. Now I'm feeling a willingness in this direction. And it's almost like suspending your thoughts, isn't it? And yet they're still active. You see, this is the beautiful thing about this approach. Thank God for the Holy Spirit and what it suggests. It's so fresh in the moment and suggesting to us, outside of any orthodoxy, you know, we don't need to pore over books necessarily to find anything. It just arises in your mind, like, try this, neither nor. And it's a beautiful, beautiful way to handle our continuity fear. See, our path here, unlike any other path that I've ever seen, emphasizes the continuity fear. This is our path. Okay. And I feel it's a better path than other paths. I really do. Because it's really the only problem we have. And by being conscious of this problem, we become open to more elegant, pragmatic solutions. Okay. So I do favor this path. Absolutely, I do favor it. I respect others, but I absolutely favor this path. And so the Holy Spirit, you know, what it advises us is to help us through this continuity fear that we have. We're afraid of dropping our pretending, which is what we've been engaged in to such an extraordinary extent and intensity and creativity for so long, for so many moments, so repetitive, so many habits built up of pretending, that we have reached the false conclusion that pretending is our functioning. Now, identity is meaningless without a functioning, right? So essentially, we believe pretending is our identity. So to see that this is all just our pretend, well, first of all, we're afraid to stop pretending. We think we'll have no identity then, no function, therefore no identity will be annihilated. This is called the continuity fear. This is really the root of our trouble. And we are so afraid to stop pretending that we insist that the cause of this pretending is not coming from us, from spirit, but coming from some other mind, mortal mind, we call it, the false self, the ego. We've invented a self, the ego, we call it the ego, the I, the false self, mortal mind. It's all talking about the same situation where we have just imagined that there's some other causative factor other than spirit doing the pretending. And then we imagine that enlightenment applies to this other mortal mind, that mortal mind needs to be enlightened to be happy, so it will, what, keep on pretending, right? So it will, or it will remain in an enlightened condition permanently. What we're really trying to do is make it real. So in our striving for enlightenment, we're trying to make the mortal mind real so that we never can recognize that it's us that's doing the pretending, actually. Because we feel that would be, when we recognize it, that it's all pretense, then we would be realize that we can stop it. You see, we can stop pretending. And this brings up the enormous continuity fear of annihilation. So we defend against this continuity fear of annihilation by believing in this ego, false self, mortal mind, and then trying to enlighten this mortal mind so that it is permanent, that it's happy, stable, permanent. Now, you just let this sink in, because the fear dynamic is so extreme in trying to get past this. It's a wow factor. Just the fact that we see it like this now so clearly, it's just like, wow. I hope I can keep my functioning. So, part of our functioning in this pretending to be, not to be something other than what we are, and we're doing this to try and be greater than God, to actually, to convince to die to what we are, which means God would have to die to what God is. To change what we are means we actually change what God is, because God, we're an extension of God, extension of God's will. So if we can change what we are, it means we've changed what God is, which means we're greater than God. So that's the purpose of it. Ultimately, it's just the silly adventure we're engaged in. But the fear factor is certainly extreme for us. We're afraid to stop pretending. So we have to keep working on this causative factor of this world other than our own pretense. And our efforts at enlightenment are towards that, actually. Isn't that extraordinary? We've been trying to enlighten what doesn't exist. Try to stabilize it, you know, as if when it reaches enlightenment, it means it does exist. You know, so really our efforts at enlightenment is almost like trying to create, you know, make it causative. Make some what is just mere pretense causative, which is impossible. So you might say enlightenment is seeing through this whole situation. You know, however, the continuity fear is there. We don't want to stop all our pretending. It's too severe for us. Okay. But can we have it in a minimal way? A minimal way, all right, as we get used to the accepting that, hey, this has all been pretense, all of it. We're willing to say a lot of it's pretense, but to say that all of it has just been pretense is where the severe fear is, and we're not trying to force the issue there. However, knowing how to evaporate the continuity fear, we realize that there can be sort of an intermediate step where we're still pretending, but what we are pretending gets rid of all other pretending. In a way of speaking. For example, the neither nor. We can still have thinking and believing that we can say, well, this thinking is arising, somehow it's there, and we don't have to make it so causative. What's the cause of it? We know it's us, but we don't want the final step of ceasing all our thinking, you see. So we can say, yeah, I know that I'm the one who's pretending all this. But I still want at least a vestige of the thinking seeming to be somewhat autonomous, you know. So I don't want to completely cease it. So put the thinking into this format of neither nor, and let it stay. Let it stay. Let it stay as a cloud in the distance. And so you can look up in the cloud in the distance and say, ah, I'm just happy for right now to have that cloud in the distance, because it's honoring my creativity. We don't want to cease pretending, because we want to find a way to honor our creativity, because there's been massive creativity in this pretending that we've done. Massive creativity in this. And if we cease our pretending, then that's, you know, that's the end to the pretending. And so we're reluctant to do this, and we don't have to do it. The Holy Spirit knows all of this dynamic. So how about just allow thoughts to remain, and yet all our thoughts now are in this just neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor format. And so you might say all the thoughts are the same, and they're beautifully don't go anywhere, not there, but they can all still be, but it's neither this nor that. It's neither this nor that. This thought is neither this nor that. It's neither a thought nor not a thought. Neither a thought nor not a thought. The thought, neither a thought nor not a thought. And just let it be this cloud in the distance. So we don't have to judge between any of the thoughts. And yet there's still that security blanket. Well, the thoughts are still there in a cloud. It's like a child with their security blanket. When they grow older, you know, they may still have it up in the closet, and they don't throw it out. They never look at it, but in the back of their mind, they know it's still there. I remember when my parents threw out my security blanket without telling me. You know, I was older and never look at it, anything, but I was so upset. I was so angry. They should have at least told me, right? So this shows you that there is this principle. Even though we put the security blanket away, put it in the closet, it's been 10 years since we even looked at it, and we think we've forgotten all about it, but if our parents throw it away, we're going to be furious. We'll be furious because we want to have one last, you know, look at it and have a moment, you know, before we release that finally. And we spiritually, we're like that. We don't want to throw all our thoughts away entirely. We do not. And we don't have to. We don't have to. And this way that I see of the continuity fear, I feel it's going to develop into a much more streamlined, better path than the other paths that have been in this world over the last several thousand years. So that's why I seem to be a maverick at this point, but it's really a pioneer. I'm much more of a pioneer, pioneering this new way, which I feel is vastly superior. To from the start emphasize the continuity problem is the only problem there is. This is the basic creed. You know, we don't need the Chalcedonian creed. Our creed is the continuity problem is the only problem that I have. I don't have any other problem. This problem about some such and such doesn't exist. Only the continuity problem exists. This is the basic creed, that we have this Gandhi problem. Once we have that as the base, then the entire situation, what the Holy Spirit suggests to us, we'll say, oh, yeah, that really seems like great advice. Whereas if we didn't recognize the continuity problem, we wouldn't understand it. So way too much of our efforts have gone towards trying to stabilize the ego. And now, but there have been so many creative efforts, we don't want to throw all effort away. So we keep the cloud of effort, okay? The cloud of effort, we keep it in the sky, in our sky. We don't want to have a completely clear sky at this point. We don't want to throw away our security blanket, and nor should we. Because it is an expression of our God-created creativity. So we simply keep that cloud in the sky, and all thoughts we transform all thoughts into neither nor. It's just neither nor, the cloud of neither nor. Problem solved. Let me recognize that the problem has been solved. Is a quote from Jesus in A Course in Miracles. Let me recognize that the problem has been solved. And we can keep that cloud in the sky as long as we want. There's no reason to try to get rid of it. Jesus tells us that ultimately God will decide the final step for us. We need not be concerned about that. But what's wrong with having a nice little cloud in the sky? And we know it's just our thoughts that it symbolizes all our efforts that we have put in, our massive, massive efforts that we have engaged in, trying to deceive ourselves, trying to change what we are. And we should have that cloud in the sky to honor our efforts, to honor our creativity. And yet, to help us take our attention off of that cloud, just like a security blanket in the closet, we don't need to pay attention to it. We put all thoughts in, just they're neither nor. All thoughts are now neither nor. It's neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that. Now, this is a revolutionary concept. I mean, a way of looking at it, isn't it? But this is what this video channel here is for, is to present these very novel, beautiful ways, new ways of looking at flipping the script. We flip the script. We're not bound by any tradition here. Absolutely not bound at all. We will do, this is really the path of the Holy Spirit. This is really the teachings of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't have quote-unquote teachings. It's fresh. It gives us clarity in the moment and helps us flip the script and say, hey, you know, moving forward, there's a better way. There's a better way. There is. And there's a lot of mavericks. There are a lot of mavericks out there that are looking for, you know, looking for to streamline the whole situation. And so we're not bound by orthodoxy or tradition at all. And we don't really take any input from them so much, because, you know, this is a new way that we're doing, and this is what we're focused on here. We're focused on being successful with this way. Okay, we're not trying to do, we're not engaged in a comparative religion sort of thing, comparative theology, comparative this, comparative that. We might make some comments, etc., etc., sure, but I'm convinced that we have to find a better way. I've always desired to find a way which takes the best of everything, leaves the troublesomeness of everything, and do I have enough space here? Yeah. And yet it brings the Holy Spirit in and focuses on the continuity fear, the problem. This is our problem. It's the only problem we have. It's what drives us to try and deify the ego, which is what most are trying to do. I'm reading the Silicon Valley Business Journal, something where online, looking at it, because I was trying to figure out what those explosions were last night. I thought I was looking for some news, and it, you know, it came up here, news, so somehow I got there. There's no news on those big explosions last night. Very odd. And all this tech news, oh my God, how sickening. And, you know, streaming media content, it's all about media content, video content, Facebook's getting videos, you know. And I said, what content? There isn't any content in this world. I can't find a single bit of content that interests me. So they have all these gadgets designed to stream content, but there's no content. Very, very bizarre. I literally, if you told me, you know, ask me, where can I go for content? Can't find any. I've never been able to find any real content. This is why I do the videos, just to provide content for the world. You know, all the efforts to deify, stabilize, enlighten, deify the ego, the false self, this false causative causation is no content at all. There's no content there. However, it is creative, okay, in a certain way. It's our creativity at work. But It's much ado about nothing. It's much ado about nothing, and it doesn't. It just sort of increases the continuity of fear because we keep pretending, and our pretending is wrapped up now in the deification of the ego, attempting to stabilize this false causation. It doesn't exist. So we believe that the pretending, if we see as pretending, we'll just throw up our hands and say, well, I mean, nothing I can do about it. You know, that's just what's happening. I mean, I'm not doing it. There's just the mortal minds doing it. And, you know, even if we saw it was pretense, we still say, well, it's not us that's doing it, so we can't stop it. You see how this is. What we're afraid of is to recognize that we are the ones who are pretending all of this, and there's no other pretender at all. That's what shocks us and frightens us. And so I don't recommend that sort of realization directly, because this causes a backlash. So what we're doing is we're honoring ourselves, our creativity. We have a much more positive sort of framework to deal with this. And we say, we don't have to. Okay, fine. You know, we're pretending, oh, this is all fine. So, but let's keep a token, you know, of that great effort at pretense. Let's keep it on the shelf. That's fine. Let's still have it around, but in a way which doesn't distract us. So we're not thinking, okay, what am I thinking now? We're not paying attention. Oh, my thoughts, I wonder what they're doing now. Now we say, no, all thoughts are neither nor. They're all neither nor. They're still there. They can be millions of thoughts, but they're all neither nor. There can be all this activity, but it's all just neither nor. And it's just off in this cloud there. I might see it in... Ah, there's that cloud that honoring my creativity in the sky. Wonderful, wonderful. Now those who are saying, no, you must push all the way, you must get in total enlightenment. So those are the egotists, actually. They're trying to enlighten the ego. They don't understand, realize that. You see, what we are doesn't have any need for enlightenment. Reality doesn't have any need for enlightenment. Reality isn't spiritual in the way that we think of it. We only think reality is spiritual in relation to our pretense, you know, but reality just is what it is. Perfect freedom. But there's no concept of that at all. So we don't need to be enlightened. We just need to resolve the continuity fear. And, you know, ultimately, we'll stop pretending to be, try to be what we're not. But when we put this pretending into just a neither nor format, so all our pretense now is just this neither nor cloud, this cloud of neither nor. That, and it's still there. We say, great, great. I don't want to, you know, I don't want that to vanish at this point. I don't. So, you might even say, paradoxically, that the real way, that what really works is to not be enlightened. Try not to be enlightened. But positively work to get that cloud there in the sky of neither nor, and make sure it is there. Because once it's there in a neither nor format, we can relax and abide in the perfect stability of our true nature. So is more, instead of trying to abide in our true nature, you know, as like quote unquote enlightenment, we should really be working for an agreement within our being, to put that cloud, that neither nor cloud there. All our pretense is now just a neither nor format. And we will find that there's this inner accord about this. At some point, there has to be a freshening up. Jesus said, don't put new wine into old wineskins. So there has to be a freshening of the path and a fresh way to look at it, which is what we're pioneering here. You see, we don't have to have the concept that I am enlightened. We will naturally, as we reach this accord, we will just naturally feel the natural state of, I would say, the best way to describe it would be this perfect inclusivity with no way to ever not feel this perfect inclusivity. I mean, it's just this total immersion inclusivity in the one family, in the oneness, the one mind. Jesus tells us in reality there's just one mind. He says if there's an idea, an aspect of that mind wants it to reign, the entire mind agrees that it shall reign. It's like this. It's just one total mind, oneness. So, so there's this complete inclusivity. If we're not trying to describe it here, but just sort of a vague way of, I would say, this is what I experienced. Is this sense of eternal inclusivity and family. Everyone's a part of the one family, equally part of it, equally inclusive, and there's no way to ever leave it or get kicked out of it or anything like this. And so that's just naturally there. It's just naturally there. We don't have to think of it as spiritual or anything, but we have to be wise right now in our situation because of this severe continuity fear, because of this massive pretending we've done. All our creativity wrapped up in that. It's deeper than we think. And to make the goal, to reach this accord within us, an agreement, a detente within us, this is really the goal. This is really the goal. Once we can accept this detente, then, you know, that's it. We've made it. Because ultimately, at some point, there will be a God. God will somehow take the final step for us when it's all, everything is perfectly right for us, then we can, you know, move on. But we don't even need to think about that. We need this detente, this inner detente of accepting our creativity, what we've done, and honoring our creativity in a way that gives us this peace of mind, this stability, this feeling that I'm, you know, absolutely perfectly inclusive, and nothing, and there's no, and an acceptance that there's no reactivity of God to anything we've done whatsoever, just abiding in this. You know, if you have this crystalline, beautiful, clear blue sky, and but you have one cloud there, you know, does it really ruin the experience? No, it doesn't. It doesn't. Because we know the cloud is symbolizing our creativity of this effort to pretend that, you know, we're not. And so that's also, you know, that's endearing to us. So it doesn't bother the endearment of the whole situation that we're feeling at all. But we certainly cannot still believe that these thoughts are purposeful, you know. So we recognize they're not purposeful, but we don't do it in a direct judgmental way. We just say, okay, well, this thought is neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither this nor that. It's neither this nor that. It's both purposeful and not purposeful. It's neither purposeful nor not purposeful. and we allow the thoughts to remain in this format. And there's no need to judge anything then about our thoughts. The thoughts still remain, but it's not in a way that draws our judgment to them in any way. So I think that the world doesn't really understand this path yet. And so it draws wrong conclusions, thinking, wait a minute, you can't do this because... No, it doesn't understand that we are honoring ourselves. This is a path of honoring our creativity. Recognize the continuity problem, recognizing that honoring our creativity in this neither nor way is the ultimate solution to this continuity problem, that it seems very acceptable to me. I'm just working on this thing. Is this acceptable? And I feel that it is. I feel that it is. And again, back to the security blanket. We may be 15 years old and someone throws out a security blanket and we think that we're over our childhood. And that parents say, well, parents may think, well, they're over their childhood. They're 15 years old now, so I'll throw it away. Guess what? We're honoring our childhood. We're not ready to just have the memories thrown away, you know? We're not. And that's perfectly okay. Why should we? Why should we say, oh, yeah, you know, my childhood, that was nothing? What do you mean it was nothing? It wasn't nothing. It's how I got here, you know? It's how I got here now. So, and this pretending to be what we're not, you know, this we've been engaged in this to an extreme extent. This is part of our experiencing, part of our freedom that we've been experiencing using our creativity this way. We don't just throw it in the trash it's easy to say, well, it's just nothing, you know. As much as we say, yeah, it's nothing. But that leaves out the component, a deeper component that we have. So, which is that we love to use our creativity. We're created that way. We're created to love being creative, to love our creativity. And so we do love what we have done, even though it was an attempt to destroy our creativity. So we don't just say, hey, you know, we used our creativity to try to destroy our creativity. Let's just throw that away like it never happened. No, it doesn't work that way. Because we have loved, we inherently love using our creativity. Even using it to try to destroy creativity, we still love it. So we need to allow this honoring of this, even though we know, hey, I'm ready to move on. I'm going to move on soon. I really want to move on from this and use creativity in a way that I, you know, enjoy more than, you know, trying to destroy creativity. And yet, by no means do we want to just junk it, you know, in an angry, hostile manner, like, get rid of this, let's just burn it, let's get rid of it. No. But neither do we want to anymore entertain these thoughts. We don't want to entertain these thoughts, these foolish thoughts of reactivity, as if symbolizing reactivity has some sort of sympathetic magic to reality, that somehow God is reacting to the appearancing, to our creativity. God does not react to our creativity except through love. It's all love. There's no reactivity, it's just pure love. So we're trying to get something other than pure love. So thoughts are reacting to other thoughts. We've imagined this system of reactivity. So now we're going to keep the system of reactivity, okay, but we're going to put it in the format of neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that. Now, some might say, well, you know, well, that'll drive people insane or something. Well, no, it won't, because the only ones who will, this has to be agreed to at a very deep level, with, through love and clarity and wisdom, and you know, otherwise it's not going to happen at all. You're not going to be able to transform all your thoughts into neither nor format until you have this deep yes and under and appreciation, and you say, okay, it's a go, I'm going to do that. It's not going to happen at all. And nobody's going to practice neither nor and try to, you know, force the issue on themselves, because they can't force the issue on themselves. It's built-in safety. There's no lack of safety in this at all, because it would just be empty repetition. Neither nor. No, we can have our entire thought content, the whole psyche, egoic psyche, we call this whole mechanism of reactivity, we can have that transformed into just a neither nor format by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was not going to do that until we're ready for it. So, you know, to say there's some danger in it means the Holy Spirit is reckless, and that's not possible. The Holy Spirit is not reckless. Now, people will say, well, you can't make any progress. You're not going to get anywhere with what? Get anywhere with what? With thoughts? With reactivity? Where is that supposed to get? You know, it's just a way of symbolizing the belief that God is changeable, that God reacts to our creativity in some way other than pure love. And this isn't true. It will never happen. So it's just a dance of futility. You know, and at some point we get tired of this dance of futility, this reactivity. It's that we don't want reactivity. We want peace, creativity, and love, which is our that's our true nature. So, stability, freedom, bliss. Neither nor. I mean, all this reactivity is just a simulation, a way to try to find some way to get God to react, and that will never happen. So it's just, you know, there's much ado about nothing, to say the least. There isn't anything to learn from it at all. There's no goal, so how can there be learning? It's just aimless wandering around. It's really neither nor already. It's already neither nor, but we can have that officially, you know, recognized, and the Holy Spirit enable us to see it that way, just like a cloud in the sky. Neither nor, but it's a benign cloud. When it's neither nor, it's this beautiful benign cloud. It's not some huge, you know, stormy system of reactivity at all, which is what the world is going to unleash upon us very soon, a massive storm of reactivity, trying to isolate the winners and the losers. And the winners, the idea is the winners symbolize those who are, you know, greater egotists, so to speak, as if reactivity is some sort of identity, you know. That this is causal. This is causing the pretending. This reactivity is causing the pretending. and we feel like, oh my gosh, if we just have this benign cloud of neither nor, then, I mean, we won't be able to see as causative of our pretending. All that, of course, we'll realize that we're the ones, that the Spirit's the one that's been pretending. And then we say, whoa, what about, but, you know, honoring our creativity, how do we do that? Well, we keep the cloud of thoughts there in a benign format. non-reactive format. Neither nor format. So, just getting this information out, it's not quite smooth yet, which is, of course, that's fine. That's pioneering something, that's how it is. You know, you set up camp. You don't have some luxury palace there. You set up camp. Start the campfire. And we don't need to explain this according to some other tradition or terminology or definitions. We don't need to explain this. This is very clearly explained within our own labels and tradition and clarity. It's very easily explained. We don't need all the complexity of other traditions at all. We don't need the complexity of it. We do need to manage our success. We have a severe continuity problem. We need to manage our success. And it's like getting $1 billion every day. We're not used to it. And you know, we have to, every day it's like, wow, this is a lot easier than I thought. I'm really going to succeed. Wow. And it's important not to jump into some other practice, which is really delaying practice. So much of the world has been delaying practice. So much has been trying to enlighten the ego. So much has been trying to deify, enlighten the ego. We want to have, you know, enlightened thoughts, enlightened concepts. No, we put the thoughts and the concepts into neither nor mode. They don't need to be enlightened. We don't need to enlighten our thoughts. We only need to honor our creativity. So the world right now is scratching its head wondering, you know, how can we, you know, avoid this problem? There's no way, oh my gosh, you know, but hey, there is a way. Absolutely is a way. Easy way. And yet, managing our success is a very difficult undertaking. When you're used to being a pauper, you start getting money. You see what happens to people who grow up in the ghetto and paupers and rough life, and they athletes, they get, you know, you sign these huge, you know, contracts, $50 million, $100 million. I mean, ultimately, you look at them later and they're broke. They're broke again. This is extremely common in like football and basketball. It's just like a huge percentage, like a football player. You check into them 10 years after they retired or whatever. They're broke. They're broke. Often basketball players too. It's extraordinary. And in their career, they've earned like, you know, $140 million in their career. They're completely broke. This is a fact. They don't know how to manage their success. Nobody taught them how to manage their success. So if you really want to help someone on the spiritual path, you teach them how to manage their success. And once they learn the basics of that, doing it, then they will automatically, the Holy Spirit will bring clarity, more and more clarity into their lives. So what we can practice here, we can say yes, neither, nor, yes, neither, nor, yes, neither, nor. Yes to neither nor, yes to neither nor. See, we're not practicing to try and change anything. What we're doing is we're getting used to the idea of allowing the Holy Spirit to transform our inner landscape so that we, that all our thoughts are recognized as in the neither nor format. We're getting used to the idea. This is continuity practice is what we're doing. So we say yes to neither nor, yes to this elegant solution is what we're saying. Yes to the elegant solution, we're saying. I can agree with that. This is how we do. It's a type of assertion, right? That we get used to the idea, like how would I feel, you know, in, with agreeing with this solution? Because it's success, a successful solution. So how am I going to feel being ultimately successful here? This is what we have to practice. I'm going to have this successful, elegant remedy. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I already have it. Is the ladder we climb here. So first we talk about flipping the script. Yes, we can. Yes, we can do this. You see, that this option is there. Yes, we will is assertion. So we say, yes, yes to neither nor. Yes to neither nor. Yes to neither nor. Yes, I say yes to neither nor. I say yes to neither nor, meaning I say yes to this elegant solution of honoring our creativity without having to get any more, pay attention to our thoughts anymore, you see. So we can be at peace of mind. So yes to neither nor, yes to neither nor. This is the assertion phase of our practice. The flipping the script is yes, I can. The assertion is yes, I will. And the wow phase is a feeling like, yes, I've already done it. It's practicing the elation of having succeeded. So we practice the elation of having succeeded. It's a done deal. I've already done it. Now we can assert that too. Yes, I already know that I've already, is already, all my thoughts are already neither nor. All my thoughts are already neither nor. And then the wow is this elation from this. So we build up the wow from flipping the script, yes I can, from asserting yes I will, and then the highest assertions is yes I have already done this. And this builds up the wow, we can feel it. I'm successful, I've already succeeded, this is it, I found the elegant solution that I was looking for. Yes, yes to neither nor, yes, yes to neither nor, yes to neither nor, yes, I already have accepted neither nor, yes, all my thoughts are already neither nor, yes, yes, I can have my thoughts neither nor, yes, I will have my thoughts neither more, neither nor. Yes, I already have. Yes, all my thoughts are already. Yes, I already know that all my thoughts are already neither nor. All my thoughts are already neither nor. It's already happened. This is a very high practice that's already happened. So, like, there's a river we need to cross. I say, oh, you see, oh, I see that because there's a situation, the river, you know, I can have this opportunity. I have this opportunity here. So yes, I can. I can. I can engage with this. I can engage with this. This river crossing. Yes, I will means I have the will that I am going to, I am engaging with it, because this is the, I have the will to do it. Yes, I will do this. I will do this. I have decided that it's going to happen for me. And then I already know that I've already crossed. I'm already on the other side. As we've decided that we've agreed that we have crossed the river. This is where we are. We've agreed to the solution. We've agreed to be on the other side of the river. And the elation then of wow, it wasn't an obstacle after all. We decided that the river is actually no obstacle at all. And we agree that we neither crossed it nor did nor crossed it all, neither nor. Did we cross it, or were we already on the other side, you see? Or were we on both sides? And we're just now aware of the part of us that's on the other side of it, so to speak. You can play with this, but it's not that important. It's neither yes to neither nor. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I already am neither nor. This is neither nor. All thoughts are neither nor. Yes to neither nor. All my thoughts are already neither nor. Yes, I already know that all my thoughts are already neither nor. Now, I may have trillions of thoughts and neither nor. They don't mean anything anymore, as obvious as it, but at least I can look up on the sky, so to speak, of the inner landscape, the inner sky, and say, ah, yeah. That reminds me of all the trillions of thoughts and the great creativity that I put forth. So that was really quite a wild and wacky adventure. You know, it's sort of just some vague, you know, it's a nice reminder. It's a nice reminder. Trillions of meaningless thoughts on this very benign, calm cloud. Not some thunder cloud. There's no reactivity in it anymore. It's a very benign cloud. So, now, there are two ways to react to this. The egoic way is to intellectualize it and say, okay, I think I got it. My mind is it. That's not the way. It's the wrong way. That's the egoic way. Rather, our way is to react to it, is recognize the wow of this. Instead of saying, okay, I think I have it now. So we're supposed to see the thoughts are yes and no. I put it in a cloud, the sky. I'm trying to, you know, get a map of this. I'm trying to think of it. Okay, now. We don't do that. What we say is, wow, this is awesome. This feels awesome. This feels like, you know, liberation. This is tremendous. I love this. You know, I'm grateful for this. I feel elated. And so we decide to feel the wow. And let that permeate us in relation to this idea. We don't go into the thinking and intellectualizing and structuring and all this kind of stuff at all. We don't go into the left mind, left brain, so to speak. We go extreme right. It's wow. Wow is extreme right-mindedness. We just, wow, the beauty is so beautiful. Wow, I love this. I love this resolution. Wow, this is just astonishingly acceptable to me. And feel that. Don't try to force a feeling. Just let it be. Just be aware of it when you know. We can block it out if we go into the intellect of categorizing, labeling, you know, numbering, arranging, all this kind of stuff. We don't go into that. We don't go into that at all. Because we just go into the wow of it. Wow. Now, it's pretty stressful to go into the wow. So it's a workout. We accept the workout. We're not wimps here. You know, we take the challenge that this is a workout for us. We don't wimp out by going into the left brain intellectualizations and emotionalizations and reaction formations of all these various kinds of defensiveness. This defensiveness, we're willing to feel the wow of it. Don't wimp out, feel the wow. Alright, do not wimp out, feel the wow. Don't force anything. But just become aware that you might be in a state of almost, you know, delirium. I mean,